Andrew, I see you nodding your head. It's the pre-election budget.
Yeah, it's hard to call it a budget at all. I mean, budgets traditionally were about the government's spending and tax plans and then about the economy at large. And at a time when there's a lot of real concerns about the economy and their future, both short-term and long-term growth, whether you're talking about the headwinds from a aging population or the U.S. tax reform bill and the challenge that presents, a whole range of things, and there's virtually nothing about serious about growth in this budget. You know, I think they call it the equality plus growth budget, but the equality part got a nine-tenths of it. What can you say about a budget where about a third of it is just about the process of the budget itself, this so-called gender-based budgeting? I mean, you know when you've got space to fill when you go on a kind of an ideological tear about institutionalizing the permanent revolution of we're going to, you know, put everything through a feminist lens from here to eternity, and very little about the actual stuff of budgeting, which is as most governments have conceived it until now.
As a woman, I'm going to say that's not so bad.
Well, it depends on your perspective. You don't necessarily benefit women by artificially jacking up wages, for example, if a bunch of them get thrown out of work as a process.
Barb, major narratives for you.
Well, in keeping with what my colleagues have been saying, there was a lot of, they covered a lot of bases, and they sort of looked through the getting women and getting disadvantaged players into the workforce. There was a lot of sort of policy talk. There was some spending, but a lot of it was sort of framing things, I think. And one economist I spoke to even talked about it being experimental, that we're not really going to see this play out for 5 to 10 years, and that some things will, you know, have dividends, but some will be more muted.
So where are these new revenue streams coming from?
God knows. There's no, I didn't see any increase in taxes in this bill. They'll be careful about that, you know, with the election coming up. It's from continued economic growth. Now, I'm sure their forecasts are reasonably prudent in that regard because they're based off of private sector forecasts. But we're all basically crossing our fingers and hoping we don't have a recession ever. Right, we're 10 years into a recovery, and this continued, as John said, that, you know, the reduction of the debt GDP ratio and the continued declining deficits depends upon continued economic growth, no increase in interest rates, all these kinds of things which may or may not transpire. So it doesn't mean we're all going to hell, but you'd think at this stage there'd be some mention somewhere about when we're going to balance the budget and start paying down debt, and it just doesn't even occur to them. It doesn't matter to them at all, and they're certainly signaling that.
Those deficits aren't going away, are they?
Well, I think that they've got them. I mean, it's a $2 trillion economy. We've got it. We're somewhere close to $12 billion in the out years. So, you know, I think that they're in reasonable shape, but they're in reasonable enough shape that they could have done things in this budget to signal to, not just to the business community in this country, but to investors overseas as well, that we want to remain competitive. I mean, the Trump administration has just brought in a whole raft of tax changes. It's also brought in a provision whereby if you invest in machinery, for example, you can write that piece of machinery off as an expense in year one. Now, if you're comparing that to what you can do in Canada, you can't do that in Canada. He could have, even in a targeted fashion in technology industries or in AI or whatever, said if you invest in machinery in Canada in this year, we've got the financial capacity for you to be able to write that equipment off. Or he could have done something on corporate taxes, or he could have done something else. He did none of the above, and what he said in his remarks was that, you know, we want to do our homework, we want to see what the provisions are in the States, because as he said, that the Trump administration has not even fully finished them yet. And that's fair enough too, but there is a crisis, I think, in sentiment in this country. I mean, we're already seeing money being pulled out of exchange-traded funds in for energy stocks in Canada and being put into U.S. ETFs. You know, these are the types of things that governments have to send out the message, we understand what's going on and we're prepared to respond. They didn't want to respond this year. This is a year three budget. And their political instincts trumped what is probably good for the economy because it didn't fit in with their long-range electioneering plans, and those plans consisted of having spent heavily in years one and two, keeping their powder dry in year three, and then blowing the lot in year four, I suspect.
And suppressing the NDP vote.
Well, so this is all about the NDP vote. I mean, frankly, this is all about the NDP. If you look, and obviously beating the Conservatives in other writings, but so I mentioned official languages. There's $400 million there for official languages. That's not going to be spent in Quebec. That's going to be spent on English in French in English provinces. and in New Brunswick, for example. There are 25 ridings where one in five or more speak French as their first language, and they are key ridings. You know, it's no surprise they're spending $400 million over 5 years because they want to win in St. Boniface in Winnipeg, they want to win in Ottawa Orleans, they want to win in Francophone ridings in New Brunswick. That's where their focus is in this budget. It is not in keeping Canada competitive vis-a-vis Donald Trump's tax cuts.